H-E-C-K-E-R, and today I am speaking to Jim Sanders. It is October the 27th, 1997, and we are in Weimar, in Buchenwald actually, Thuringia, Germany. Mr. Sanders, could you tell us your full name?
Yes, I can. James A. Sanders, but I go by Jim.
Could you spell your name?
J-A-M-E-S-A-S-A-N-D-E-R-S.
And what does the A stand for?
A stands for A-L-D-E-N, Alden.
Thank you. When were you born?
I was born January 4th, 1925.
So you are how old now?
I am 72 years old, soon to be 73.
What was the name of your parents?
The name of my parents, Lyman Andrews Sanders and Inez, I-N-E-Z, May Sanders.
Could you spell?
I mean, Ahrens was her maiden name.
Could you spell that, please?
A-H-R-E-N-S.
And your father's first name, could you spell that, please?
L-Y-M-A-N.
And where were you born?
I was born in Omaha, Nebraska. USA.
And do you have any siblings?
Yes, I have four children. Oh, brothers, you mean brothers and sisters, okay. Siblings, yes, I have four.
And what are their names?
Catherine Rogers. Would you like me to spell it?
Yes, please.
C-A-T-H-R-Y-N-R-O G-E-R-S. And then I have a brother, Alan Sanders, A-L-A-N S-A-N-D-E-R-S. And Clifford, C-L-I-F-F-O-R-D. Sheldon, S-H-E-L-D-O-N Sanders. And a younger brother, Gerald, J-E-R-A-L-D Wayne, W-A-Y-N-E, Sanders, S-A-N-D-E-R-S.
And what occupation does your father, or did your father?
He was a farmer in California, in Iowa and California. Mm-hmm.
So you grew up on a ranch?
I grew up on a farm and a ranch, yes. Mm-hmm. It's called a farm in the Midwest and a ranch in California.
I see.
It's land.
And what did you like to do when you were a kid?
When I was a kid, well, when we were children, some 55 years ago, we all had work to do on the farm. There were no televisions, of course, and the only thing we had was a radio that we'd listen to in the evening, but we all had our chores to do. Uh-huh. Summertime was lots of work to do.
Was there anything you especially liked to do?
Especially liked to do? Well, we liked to go swimming in the canals, yes. Uh-huh. I liked to build model airplanes, things like that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Was your family religious?
I would say semi. My mother was probably more so than my father. Mm-hmm.
Which religion would that be?
Congregational in Iowa. And they were basically Congregationalists. Mm-hmm.
Was religion important for you?
Was it important for me? Early on, it was. I'd say from probably as soon as I was conscious of it, which had been 5 or 6 years of age until I was 15 or 16. Mm-hmm.
What does that mean? Did you go to Sunday school?
Went to Sunday school, church. Mm-hmm.
Did you have any Jewish friends?
Pardon?
Did you have any Jewish friends when you were a kid?
Jewish friends? I could have had, but no one identified anyone Jewish, whatever, German. We had Japanese friends, but you could always tell who a Japanese person was.
Did you know anything about Jews when you were a kid?
Well, even when I was a child, the adults had Jewish jokes. True. Mm-hmm. I've heard my father say "Ikey," you know. I didn't know, of course, what that meant, but wasn't any big thing in my life. No.
So did you form an impression through that comment?
No, I didn't. No. Mm-mm. No, I did not.
So how old were you when the war in Europe broke out, 1939?
1939, I would have been 14 years old. Uh-huh, so it broke out in September of 1939. I was 14 years old.
So you probably went to school?
Yes, yes, I did. I was in high school. Uh-huh.
What did you hear about that?
We heard only news we would get would be through the newspaper or the radio. We heard that the Nazi armies had invaded Poland and so on. In school, we heard about it, too. The teachers, history class, would discuss it, war. But it didn't mean much to us at that point. It didn't mean much to us until Pearl Harbor, December 7th, 1941. Then it meant a lot to us.
What? What did it mean to you then?
It meant we were at war with the Japanese. And at the same time, then declared war on Germany and the Axis powers. Mm-hmm.
You mentioned that you heard about, that you spoke about the war in Europe in history class. Mm-hmm. Can you remember what was spoken?
Not really. Only that the Third Reich wanted more land. And was willing to go after it. And we did learn about appeasement, that the other countries were appeasing. I remember talking about appeasement and how that. I remember this teacher didn't believe that it was going to work, and it really didn't, did it?
And did you have any impression what a Nazi was?
No. Just bad.
Nobody explained to you what a Nazi was or what they were believing in, or?
Not really. Not at that point, no. We didn't get that indoctrination until we were actually in the Army.
When did you join the Army?
When I was 18, and it was about, I've got my records here somewhere. It was around February of 1943. February, March, mm-hmm. 1943. I was 18 in January, and in February or March, I went in to the service.
Were you drafted?
Yes, I was drafted. Uh-huh. A strange thing at that time, though, everybody wanted to be in. And it's much different than it was in the later wars, like Vietnam. Everybody wanted to go, and everybody wanted to fly, and I wanted to fly myself, but I tried to get in the Air Force, but my eyes weren't good enough. They had enough men with perfect eyes that they didn't need me.
Why do you think everybody wanted to be in the Army?
I don't know, just the idea that somebody was going to take over the world. I mean, that was propaganda. Somebody wanted to take over the world, and especially after the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor, and then they took the Philippines, and we knew we had to do it. It had to be done. So everybody was behind it. It was, as one book writer said, it's probably the last good war. Good war. There are no good wars, but it was the last one that everybody was really behind. Korea, they weren't behind. police action. In Vietnam, they certainly weren't behind.
What did your parents say when you joined the army?
What did my parents say? My mother prayed a lot, she said. And I really don't know what my father thought about it. I don't. I don't know what he thought about it at all. I don't think I saw a tear in his eye when he took me to the bus to go in. And I don't remember him saying good luck or anything. Not that he didn't love me or particularly, just I don't think he knew what to say. I think I know what to say to my children, but he didn't.
And what about your brothers?
My brothers were too young. They weren't in the Second World War.
Did they look up to you?
Pardon?
Did they look up to you?
I don't really know. I was, my youngest brother was 13 years younger than I was, so he was just a child. And today he said, today he tells me we're partners in some ranch property, and he tells me, you were my idol. And I say, oh, come on, Jerry. But that's what he says. So who knows?
So what happened when you got drafted?
Pardon?
What happened when you got drafted?
Got drafted and you got your shots and you got your clothing and you went to basic training.
Where was that?
That was in Camp Carson, Colorado, in Colorado Springs, Colorado. Mm-hmm. We were there about 8 months and trained, got our vehicles, and then in the fall went to Tennessee for maneuvers.
And how were you prepared during that basic training?
Just basic medical and then driving. We did a lot of motor marches where we drove in convoys, trying to keep the pace between the other ambulances.
Mm-hmm. But were you talking about with the other soldiers or your superiors, were you talking about going to Germany maybe?
No.
Were you expecting?
We didn't know where we were going. And not until later on did we find out where we were going. We didn't know about going to Germany. We didn't know. We may have gone to the Pacific.
So you did not expect to go to Europe?
We didn't know. I wouldn't say we didn't expect. We just didn't know where we'd go. But then after maneuvers in Tennessee, we knew we were going to go to Europe.
Mm-hmm. What was that like, to know that you would be going there?
To young boys, another adventure. Keep moving. Let's see what happens. Let's see what's over the next hill.
Mm-hmm. Well, so then you knew you would be fighting Germans. What was your impressions of Germans?
Well, I was a medic. I wasn't going to be fighting Germans. I was going to be trying to help the wounded. I didn't want to shoot anybody.
Did you volunteer to become a medic, or was that
just... No, we were assigned. I was assigned because I knew how to drive already. I'd worked in a service station. I knew equipment. I'd been on a ranch. I'd driven equipment. So they probably felt, well, this young man probably knows how to drive, and we'll teach him how to be a medic and, bandages and set a splint and so on.
Well,
and then they took so many, okay, you will be cooks, you will be infantry, you will be whatever. Do you suppose the German army did it the same way? Probably.
So, but you and the other young soldiers you were with, you were all very young.
All very young.
What impression did you have of the Huns or the Germans?
They were just bad. We had to do something. Here it says right here in this little booklet that they gave me, don't deal with the Germans, That's from 1944, 45. It says right here, experience has shown that Germans regard kindness as weakness. So what should we expect? You call that propaganda? I think Germans were getting the same type of propaganda. All right.
Had you heard anything of the persecution of the Jews?
No. Had not. If we did, we didn't understand it. Well, we knew, now wait, we knew about Kristallnacht and about that the Jews had to wear a patch, a star, a yellow star. We knew those things, but even the Jews here in Germany, I don't think, knew what was going to happen to them. Even the First World War Germans, a lot of those people were Jews. They didn't know that they weren't going to be called up again. So I don't, you know, it wasn't unusual that we didn't know. You understand?
Did you have any Jewish fellow soldiers?
Yes, we had, we had at least two. Max Simoff, he's in here. Yeah, Max was Jewish. Max Simoff, and then we had some others, too. We did have several Jewish fellows in the outfit. Every outfit did. Yes.
Have you ever talked with him or one of them about what was happening in Germany? Or can you remember them talking about it?
No, I don't recall them discussing about the Jewish situation in Germany. No, I don't. But we did have several Jewish fellows. I remember Max particularly.
So you were trained in basic?
Basic training.
Basic training, exactly. And then you were sent to Germany.
Then first we were to England. We, in January of 1944, we sailed on the Queen Mary to Glenelg, Scotland. And then we stayed in a little town called Hay, H-A-Y, on the Wye River, W-Y-E, on the border of England and Wales. We stayed there until D-Day. On D-Day, which was June 6, 1944, we had loaded all our vehicles and were on our way to the south coast of Britain. And we didn't know it was D-Day until we passed through a small village, and we heard the people say, "The invasion's on, here come the bloody meat wagons," you know, meaning the ambulances. And that's the first we knew about. But we got down to the coast of England in time to see the huge armada of airplanes and ships and gliders going constantly into Normandy. And how the Germans, I mean, why anybody had to die after that is beyond me. Why they didn't just, they tried to get rid of Hitler, but they couldn't do it.
Were you excited of the prospect to enter the first actual fights?
Yes, we were excited. Definitely. We first went into action at Avranches, which is in Normandy, in the breakout on the Brest Peninsula. And that was our first action. And it was summer. It was August 1st. And we pulled into a field where there were many wounded, and we started loading wounded. We were with the 4th Armored, which we were with at the end. But in the meantime, we're different. But I remember the first load of casualties so well. I can just see it in my mind today. In a field, and we were lined up, the ambulances, and we loaded these fellows in, 4 litters, 2 on top, 2 on the bottom. And a medical officer came along and said, "Pull him out, he's dead." And I'll never forget that. And we took him out and put someone else in, and then we were going to try to keep track of the people we carried. But by the 3rd or 4th day, we gave it up, and it was a bad scene. One other incident that I've never really ever talked about, it's kind of gruesome, but to young people, it was just unbelievable. There was a German soldier beside of the road, And nobody took him off. And each time we went by, he got smaller from equipment, you know, running over him. And I don't know whether I've ever told that story before, but that's still in my mind. And I finally got to the point where I couldn't even look to see what he was. Those are impressionable to a young man. I mean, it's an impressionable age, and you have to remember that it's, how could that stay in my brain up here all those years, and I forget things that happened, you know, last month? I don't know. Go ahead.
How many people were on an ambulance?
How many? Just two of us. Driver, we were both drivers and orderlies.
And who were you with?
His name was Raymond Lockhart, and I still in touch with him. He lives in Oregon, but he's not interested in World War II at all. Doesn't want to. He did write to me early this year, and he'd been back to Washington to see the Holocaust Museum. And he wrote me about it, and he said it was worth going to. But that's the only time he's ever spoken about it. He knew that I'd restored the old ambulance and everything, but he's not interested in discussing World War II.
But you drove the ambulance with him until the end of the war?
Until the end of the war.
Mm-hmm. Did you develop something of a friendship?
Yes. We were friends. Mm-hmm. We really were. Good friends.
So you were in Normandy in France.
Yes.
And where did you go from there?
Well, we went, first we went to Lorient on the Brest Peninsula, and then we cut back, came back, the 4th, moved back through Angers and up to Fontainebleau, south of Paris. And we didn't go into Paris because they brought the French 2nd Armored up. Division, so the French would go into Paris. So we bypassed Paris and went on to Reims, France, and then to Verdun. And then that was fall of 1944. And our supply lines were so long that we ran out of fuel. The tanks ran out of fuel. We had enough for run the ambulances. And so what that meant was the Germans regrouped at a place called Metz, France, and sort of backed up the old Siegfried line. And so then along in December, it was the Mosel River. We were at the Mosel River, and the Mosel was flooding. And we got as far east of Metz as Boulay, a place called Boulay. And the Battle of the Bulge, you've heard of the Battle of the Bulge, okay. So Patton told Eisenhower that we could be up to Luxembourg in Belgium within 3 days. So we came back to Metz, and it was the only time in the whole war that we drove with our headlights on. Other than that, we just used what we call little cat eye, just identification, just so you could see little specks of light coming. It's all we use. But we drove with our headlights on up to the Battle of the Bulge. Mm-hmm. That was in December.
Why did you drive with your headlights on?
To get up so we could see to go fast. When you have two little so-called cat eyes, you've got to be very careful and you go very slowly. Now, many times we had to carry some of those casualties back 50 miles at maybe 10 miles an hour, you know. And so we had to take care of them on the way back, you know, the wounded. They'd all had first aid. And we had to use our helmets to help them with their body fluids. And if they had plasma, we had to change a plasma bottle. But normally they made the trip okay. But sometimes they had to go a long ways, you know. And the ones that were most injured the worst made the least amount of noise. The ones that were injured the least, of course, natural. You could hear them. And so you tried to help, do what you could do.
So you got quite used to the sight of wounded and...
Oh, sure. Yeah, all away from me. And you know, we were just young, and I know when I was young, I wouldn't even stop at an accident, you know. But we got used to that in a hurry. Mm-hmm. Yes, we did. In a hurry. You had to.
So, after the Battle of the Bulge, where did you go then?
We went on into Germany to Bitburg, was our first large town, Bitburg, Germany.
Mm-hmm. So you were in Germany, and I'm sure you heard lots of stories about Germans.
That's
did
right.
you have any expectations?
Just to be careful. Yeah. Yeah. We never really had a lot of trouble with the ambulances. We did lose some ambulances. Out of the 30 ambulances in our company, we lost 7 ambulances. We had 5 or 6 wounded. But generally, we were okay. At first, when we first went in, we just didn't like the idea of being in the ambulance, of being medics. But after we got overseas and into action, we were so happy to be ambulance drivers. Because, you know, we were out of the real heavy action. That'd be shelling, you know, artillery shelling and that type of thing. I remember one time before we got to Bitburg, it was one night, and there was shell fire, phosphorus shells, and we were going along this road, and they wanted to keep the road open, and we kind of slid off into the ditch, and there was a bulldozer ready to push us out of the way, and a big truck came along with a cable and pulled us out, saved us. But we only had one accident, actually. We had one accident. I was driving one night. It was east of Metz, and coming back with a... there's another. That incident is so clear in my mind. In fact, when we were back there, and we were coming back through that part of the country a few years ago, I pulled off the Boulay and drove that road. Same. We were taking a load of wounded back to Metz, to an evac hospital, and I was driving, and the way we drove was by the top of the trees, because you couldn't, you know, it's dark, but up at the top of the trees there was light, you know, so you just kind of watched up there so they know you were staying on the road and used the cat eyes. But I saw these little identification lights coming, and I got moved over and over and further, and like this was the trees. I got over so close, and all of a sudden, this Jeep went right between me and the trees and took our front wheel and fender right off and went back, and we didn't know what happened to it, but we had 2 wounded, and one had his leg in a splint, broken leg, and when we got hit, his leg jumped out of the splint, so he was screaming. So the first thing we did was to pull his leg back out and get it splinted again. And then we went back to look at the, to see, and we had 4 walking wounded on the side and 2 litters. And we went back, and this Jeep was upside down on a couple of guys, and so... We got the walking wounded, and all of us lifted the Jeep enough to pull him out. And one man was bleeding. His head was split open. I thought he was done for. And we just took compresses and around his head. And then the next ambulance that came back, going back to the front, we stopped them and put our people in there. And then the next one, we stopped and put these 2 fellows. And we found out later that there were 5 infantry guys had gone back to Metz, and they'd gotten drunk and were going back up the front. And 3 of them just took off and left their buddies. That story is vivid too, isn't it? But what does it mean? Another story.
Thank you so far for the interview. We will make a short pause and change the tape.
Okay.
So you arrived with your ambulance in Germany.
Yes.
You were in enemy country. Did the Germans, did you meet any Germans in other than in combat?
German civilians,
yes.
But we didn't have anything to do with them. Other than if they were wounded and we could help, we did. I remember we helped evacuate an old people's home, little old ladies. They were probably my age now. And I don't know what they thought, you know, because we couldn't talk to them. But this town was under shell fire, and so they wanted to evacuate these little ladies from this. So we put them in the ambulance, and they keep trying to get out. They try, you know, you could open the doors, the back doors from the inside, and they kept trying, wanted to get out. I don't know whether they thought we were taking them away, but so we did, you know, mostly with our own wounded, but wounded German soldiers too. We carried German wounded soldiers. I told you about the SS officer.
What was with the SS officer?
Oh, one night, this SS major, he was wounded, but we didn't know how bad he was wounded. And we'd heard all the stories about the SS. So Ray said to me, "You better take your helmet and be ready in case he tries to take the ambulance away from us." He was wounded, but he spoke English perfectly. And he said, "You boys would like to go home." And we said, "Yes, we would." And he said, "Well, you boys don't realize it, but within 5 years, the Germans and the Americans will be allies against the Russians." And I'll never forget that, because we said, well, we didn't know. How did he know that we were going to be allies in 5 years? Was it just a good guess? Who knows? But that he'll always be in my memory. We didn't have to do anything. He didn't bother us. But just the idea, SS.
So when was this about?
Pardon?
When was this about?
This had to be somewhere after we crossed the Rhine. Yeah, we crossed the Rhine at Oppenheim, west of Darmstadt, on a pontoon bridge that they'd put up. The 5th Infantry Division went across in boats and got the bridgehead, and then the engineers came up and put a pontoon bridge across, and we crossed that night after they got it up.
So at this time, did you hear any news about the Germans or what they might have been doing with the Jews?
No. No, and they should have told us, I think. We should have been told. Why not? Just because we were private ambulance, PFC ambulance drivers, why shouldn't we have known what we were going to come across? We'd come across prisoner of war camps, you know, and they didn't look too bad. They were, you know, they hadn't had enough food, but they weren't, at least they weren't human skeletons. And I know we did evacuate some of those people out of the prisoner of war camps, but that was different.
So, did you encounter a concentration camp?
Yes, we did. This one right here, we're in today.
When was that?
It was, I'm sure that it was the night of the 11th that we came up the road over here on the east side of the camp.
The 9th of the 11th of
yeah,
what?
By the time we got up, the 11th of April. By the time the 4th Armored that we were following got up the hill, Edisburg Hill, it was nighttime, you know, and we saw the fire, and we knew something was happening over to the right, because we were on that side, and there was a few shots, but that wasn't unusual, because there's always was some shooting. So, and then, did I tell you this before, about then we came back that night with some casualties and went down the hill again, this same hill. And the next day we came back up.
So,
and went into the camp
just to look. Let's go through this. slowly because I didn't quite understand. You came here first. What were you, where were you positioned?
Well, we came up the road.
We can't
remember
see
that
the road
that we went up.
Yeah, but we can't see the road. That's why
it's on the would be on the east side of this camp. There's two roads. One goes up the west side of the camp, and one goes up the east side, I think, or the northwest side, and one comes up the southwest side. That's the way it is. We were on that side, and
did you know what you were approaching?
No. Didn't have any idea. No. And then we came back that night with a load of casualties, and it was quiet, quieted down. There was still some, like, fires going, but still didn't know what it was. And then the next day, we did stop. But as I told you out there, I thought we drove in. Ray said we walked in. Well, whichever way we went in, all we did was look at the ovens and get out. Later on, the next day, or maybe that day or the next day, we were involved in picking people up that had been marched out of this camp. I don't know. Now, I can't tell you whether they were being marched in or marched out, but I assume they were being marched out. Maybe they were marching them in. I don't know. But we found them in the fields, just lying in the fields, and someone ordered us. I don't know who it was, but we would have had to have orders to do it, to help pick these people up. And we couldn't communicate with them. Even if we could have communicated, they couldn't have said anything to us. And they were skin and bones. We could put two on a stretcher. You know, an American soldier, took up the whole thing. We put one's head up here, and the other head's down here, and the two of them. So we could get eight actually in there instead of the regular four. But we were so afraid of lice. And because we'd heard they had lice. And so we carried powdered DDT at that time. Powdered. And we took the cans of DDT and spread it all over them, all over ourselves, threw it all over the ambulance, thinking that was going to protect us. We didn't know any better. It probably would be more detrimental, powdered DDT, than the lice, maybe. But yeah, that was an experience, and Ray can't tell me, and I don't know where we took those people. But it makes sense that we might have brought them back here to Buchenwald because the 120th Evac Hospital had set up here, and we're taking care of people here. But whether that's where we took them, I couldn't tell you. Don't know. We did something with them because we moved on to the east.
When you moved into Buchenwald that one time, this was not on an official mission, but it was just to see.
Evidently, we stopped to see what we thought we'd seen the night before, just to see what was happening. Because there were other vehicles, military vehicles, there.
How did you explain to yourselves what you saw?
We didn't explain it. We just said, let's leave. Actually, we were scared, you know. We weren't scared for our lives. We were just afraid of what we were seeing. I mean, we'd seen other DPs, displaced person, before. On the way, after we'd crossed the Rhine, we'd see people that evidently must have escaped from wherever they were working, you know, along the roads. We're sad shape. We did see a kangaroo court once. You know what a kangaroo court is? It's just a group of people that decide they're going to try someone. And then they're, if they convicted, they're going to... And it was down near Deggendorf, which is still in Germany. And it was right toward the end of the war. The war was over. The war was over here. There shouldn't have been any more fighting after the Battle of the Bulge. If that, what was he, Colonel Stauffenberg or whoever he was, if he could have gotten rid of Hitler, I think they would have ended it. So nobody else would have had to die, but we had to carry it on clear to the end. But this was down at Deggendorf, and we saw some lights in the barn. It was night. There was a barn over there, and we saw some lights, so curious. We walked over and went in, and there was a group of DPs, displaced persons, and they had four SS. Now, they made sure they showed us the tattoos. We couldn't have done anything anyway. Didn't have any guns. We couldn't stop them. And they were holding court. I mean, we couldn't understand the language, but we knew what they were doing. And then they must have convicted them because they started to beat them, just like probably the Germans had done to them. And I thought probably they'd killed them. But some officers, American officers, came with guns and made them stop. You know, they said, hey, we don't do this kind of business. And they had us pick up these fellows for them. And I thought they were dead. They weren't dead at all. They when we got them to an aid station, they sat up on the litters and were okay. I don't, of course, know what ever happened to them.
But let's come back to Buchenwald for a moment. You were scared.
Yeah, we were scared, actually. I don't know how Ray felt, but I was scared when I saw those ovens and everything, all the bones. It was gruesome. That's what it was.
Did anybody ever explain to you what that was?
Not then. No, we didn't find out till later. The Army has a newspaper called the Stars and Stripes, and sometimes you'd get that. It had come up to the front, and we read about it then. But I did see Ordruff, too, and we were ordered to see Ordruff, which is south of Gotha.
Could you explain what Ordruff was?
It was a satellite camp of Buchenwald. Buchenwald, I learned later, had a lot of satellite camps. Mittelbau, Dora was one of them. And I think that some of the higher officers had ordered all the servicemen that were in this area to go see that so they'd know what they were fighting for, whatever.
When did you go to see Ordruff?
Well, it must have been after this, because we were back in Gotha for a couple of days, and so I think we went down from Gotha, because it's about just about 20 miles south. There's an article, I wanted to say this. Professor Hackett has written a book called The Buchenwald Report. Have you heard of it?
No.
And he, in the book, he says that the mayor of Gotha came and went home and committed suicide. But I called him up. It was the mayor of Ordruff. Ordruff is a little city, a little small village down at the bottom of the hill, and Ordruff camp was up there. And it was the Ordruff. It was the Burgermeister of Ordruff that killed himself, not Gotha. But he didn't take it out of the book.
What did you see when you went to Ordruff?
Nothing. They were all dead. Some bodies, they tried to burn some of the bodies. There was a pit. And bodies were in the pit. They were trying to get rid of all this evidence, and it was just too big a job. They couldn't do it. We came too fast. Maybe if they had another couple of weeks, they might have been able to get rid of them. I don't know.
How many bodies did you see?
Gosh, I don't know. I wouldn't have any idea. I certainly didn't count them. But we drove in there. I know we did. We drove in the gate, and we stayed in the ambulance and just watched, just looked. And you could see. You could see there was this pit. And we may have stepped out, but I don't think we stayed there. I think it was an order to go see it, and that was about it. Now, one of our sergeants did go there. And he wrote a book later on, and he was smart enough to keep a journal. And he also took pictures. And he has some, and that book is down in Gotha in the museum. I left his book there too. And he shows some pictures of Gotha with the dead inside the barracks and outside too.
You saw all these things together with your friend Ray.
Ray Lockhart.
Did you ever speak about this, these things with him?
Oh, just what a terrible scene it was. And I don't know, we may have said, how could anybody do this? But we were in a war, you know, and we'd seen dead and dying people. These people, you know, the only really dead that I can remember here at Buchenwald were around the crematorium, because maybe, for some reason, maybe it was broken or something. But there was a lot of people milling around here, but there wasn't anybody milling around at Ohrdruf. But there were a lot of people here. I heard learned later on there were possibly 20,000, but we didn't know it, had no idea. How many people were here, how many were alive, how many had been here, what the camp was, what its name was, nothing.
And you can only remember going in and seeing the crematorium?
That's all I remember. We didn't want to stay. We didn't have a reason to stay, so we didn't want to stay.
And when you picked up these people in front of Buchenwald, you were speaking about...
outside of Buchenwald.
Outside of Buchenwald. Did you ever speak about them with Ray?
We talked about... they weren't even like living people. They were like... sort of, I don't know, almost inhuman. They were just rags. And bones and little striped pajama things that they had on. It was gruesome. It really was. It was just, what can you say? I mean, how could you even express it, those things? What if you were there? What do you think you'd have done, you know?
I do not know.
I know. We had work to do. We couldn't sit down and cry.
Did you ever feel like crying?
Well, of course you feel like crying. You see people injured and dying. You feel like crying, but you can't cry. You've got to do your job. By that time, we were doing our job, just trying to survive, get through it, go home.
You had seen many wounded and dying and dead up till then. Mm-hmm. Was there a difference between the people that you had seen before and the people that you saw at Buchenwald or Ohrdruf?
Oh, sure. These people were skin and bones. I mean, they were just emancipated. They're emaciated. They weren't like anything we'd handle. Yeah, no. Mm-mm. Nothing. No.
When did you learn that most of these people were Jewish?
We didn't learn that for a long time. In fact, we learned later that not here especially, we're not mostly Jews. They were everything. I met a man about 4 years ago who was a Frenchman here, you know? So they were, in fact... Before we finish, I have something I want to read. I think it's important. It's part of Bernard Vogel's speech. He's the Prime Minister of Thuringia. And I'd like to, and I'll tell you why I'd like to read it later. You go ahead.
So you went to Ohrdruf, and from there on, where did you go?
We just went on east to Jena. Gera, is that how you pronounce it? G-E-R-A.
Gera.
And as far east as Chemnitz. And then we went south to Hof and to Nuremberg would be next, and then on down to Regensburg on the Danube. And then Deggendorf, and then crossed the border into Czechoslovakia. And on May 8th of 1945, we were in Pilsen, Czechoslovakia, on our way to Prague, but we were stopped. The war had ended. And that's the first time we'd seen the Russians. Yeah.
So what happened when the war ended?
Everybody was happy. You know, we were in a place called Pilsen, Czechoslovakia. Do you know what they make in Pilsen?
Beer.
Beer, yeah, beer. So we rolled the kegs out of the brewery, and everybody got a canteen cup, and we had a party. May 8th, and it was a beautiful, warm day, and the war was over, and it was great. The big celebration. We did have some work to do after that. There was some American and British prisoners of war about 200 miles east of Pilsen near an ersatz refinery. They'd been there for several years working in this refinery. And the Russians were supposed to move them out to us, bring them out. And a week went by and they hadn't, nothing had happened. So we took all the fuel we could get and loaded up the cans and trucks and our ambulances and went on in after these people. And we got to the place and got them all loaded. And on the way back, we must have, that's another thing I'll never forget, we must have passed 5 miles of German soldiers marching east. Every so often there was a Russian guard, you know, alongside, but they were going east, and I just always wondered how many of those people ever got back. And I don't think there's much else.
Mr. Sanders, you were just speaking about the end of the war. Mm-hmm. Then you came back to America?
When yes. Did you? I came back across Germany to Aachen, and I'd injured my leg, and so I came home through the hospitals and then had an operation in Van Nuys, California, on my knee, and then went home in February of 1946.
When did you, for the first time, hear the whole truth about the concentration camps?
Well, pardon me. You know I have your cold. Oh, right away. It was in all the newspapers, and so we knew it right away. We came home. We knew we'd been in history and hadn't recorded it.
Did that change your attitude towards Jews in any way?
Did it change my attitude? I was glad that they finally got a homeland. When was that, 1948? The UN finally gave them a homeland. And instead of just being slaughtered, they finally fought. You know, instead of just waiting for the Germans to come into the ghetto and kill them or haul them off to the camps, they started a fight. And that's why they got us a homeland, really, I think.
You mentioned that all the papers were full of the stories of the concentration camps. Did you try to tell anybody of the people that had stayed home what you had seen?
No. When we got home, my wife-to-be had just finished college. We wanted to get married, start on our life. We wanted to forget all that. This war thing and this stuff hadn't come back until 10 years ago, probably, and really hadn't gotten to me until I was invited back 2 years ago by the German government to come to the 50th commemoration of the liberation of Buchenwald. Well, then I met survivors, and then one thing led to another, and correspondence with survivors, and you met one today that came here, and I don't think he'll probably ever be exactly what we'd say right, you know, that experience that he had as a young boy. So then I started to read more about it and find out more about it, actually.
You now have children and you have grandchildren. Did your children or grandchildren ever ask you about this time?
Not a lot. I do go to, if I'm asked, I'll go to schools when they discuss Anne Frank Week or something like that. And because I was an eyewitness, I will go and say, yes, I did see these things. And if I get a tape of this, maybe I'll show it to the schools if it's appropriate.
And one last question. You said you were quite religious before the war. Did your experiences during the war change anything about that?
I became a Christian agnostic. Not an atheist. Christian agnostic. I believe in the Christian ways, but if there was a higher power, I always felt he would have been here and stopped what was happening, but it's still happening today, isn't it? All around the world, we still have these same problems. Not to the scale that it was here. Not trying to completely wipe out a race of people. But it still happens. There's still people killing people. So, I'm a Christian agnostic.
Thank you, Mr. Sanders. Is there anything else you would like to tell us?
Yes, I came over not knowing that I was going to interview, but the Shoah people wrote, we'd already signed on for a trip here in this area down in the Thuringian forest on an elder hostel trip for 2 weeks. So about a week before we'd had come, I received a letter from the Shoah. Asked me if they could interview me and to call. And so I did call, talked to the lady who signed the letter, and I told her, well, I'm going to be over here. In fact, I'll be in Weimar. So then she said, well, maybe we could do it there, you know. And I said, well, if we did, I know a man in Malmo, Sweden, that wants to do something, and he wants to do it with me. And maybe we could get together. And so that's how it worked out. Otherwise, I probably wouldn't have done it, you know. And so with this elder hostel group, they were Americans. But a lot of them were German-born. Several were German-born. In fact, two of them had been Hitler Youth. And one had a U.S. citizenship, but somehow or they got here. But I thought any American that comes to Weimar, Germany, no matter if it's going to be the cultural center of the universe in 1999, should see this memorial up here on Edisburg Hill. And they voted not to come. And I was, because I'd been here myself in 1945, April, I was embarrassed by it, that they wouldn't come the 3 or 4 kilometers. So a man named Brent Schmidt had given me this copy in English of what was spoken at the Deutsches National Theater in Weimar 2 years ago in April to the assembled ex-prisoners and some of the so-called liberators. Very few of us were there. But I'd like, just like to read about 10 minutes of what I picked out a few paragraphs of of Dr. Vogel, who is the prime minister of Thuringia. He still is. Said about this. I know it has nothing to do with what I had back in 1945. It doesn't get recorded. It still probably doesn't matter. But the title was "Look and You Will Know." And the ceremony held by the Free State of Thuringia at the Deutsches National Theater Weimar to commemorate the 50th anniversary of the liberation of the concentration camps Buchenwald and Mittelbau-Dora. And it was a speech by Dr. Bernard Vogel, the Prime Minister of Thuringia, and was attended by 700 former prisoners and a few so-called liberators. He said, "We have assembled here in the Deutsches National Theater in Weimar this morning to commemorate those who were murdered in Buchenwald, Mittelbau, Dora, and the innumerable satellite camps. We have assembled to remember the fate of the survivors who for half a century have had to live with their anguish, their pain, and their terrible memories. We are commemorating the liberation of the National Socialist camps of Thuringian soil 50 years ago. We remember the victims, and we think of the liberators. However, this day of commemoration should not only be a day of remembrance, the past and the present and the future must be considered as a continuum, and from the distressful past we must draw lessons for our lives and for a human future for generations to come. I welcome all of you here to the National Theater. It is too small to hold all of those who wanted to come. I welcome and thank in particular the former prisoners. I know how difficult it was for you to overcome your feelings and be here today. At the time of the liberation, far more than 90% of the prisoners were non-Germans. People from 51 nations were incarcerated in Buchenwald. Former prisoners from almost all these nations are present today. I thank you for undertaking this journey into your past. But at the same time, I also think of those who were prevented from coming by age or infirmity. And I also think of those who, recalling their past experiences, could not bear to return to Weimar Buchenwald. I would request the diplomatic representatives present, whom I also welcome, to bear the tidings of this day to their countries." Now, we have assembled here today instead of waiting till the Tuesday, the 11th of April, one of the unimaginable remembrance days of the century, owing to the wish that the event be held on a weekend. I know that the remembrance is difficult and more painful and disquieting the more remote in time the occasion being recalled is, the more difficult it becomes. I know the remembrance is distressing, and speaking about it is no easier. Can the crimes of the Third Reich be spoken about in any appropriate form at all? Can we find any really appropriate way to commemorate what happened 50 years ago in the National Socialist concentration camps? Can we speak about events so terrible that they almost defy words? Would it not be better to remain silent? In my opinion, no. I believe we must remember and that we must give back the word remember, its true meaning. To remember means to cause someone to internalize something. In other words, to call something to mind. That means to direct one's attention to something. We believe that the dead, like the survivors, have a right to such remembrance. In my opinion, remembrance, the conscious mental visualization of the past and the duty to keep such memories alive, is moral obligation. It links the past to the present. Those whose death and suffering must be remembered to those who survived and must still live with their memories, but it also extends to those who were born later, those two born later. The dark shadow of Buchenwald will be linked forever to Weimar, Thuringia, and Germany. There can be no silence. Buchenwald is a trauma and a nightmare for victims who found themselves in the hands of absolute power. Buchenwald is a place where the victims were systematically robbed of their human dignity. where the normal rules of civilized society no longer applied. The reality of Buchenwald was despotism, harassment, and murder. We can realize how the people in Buchenwald suffered. They were not nameless numbers, but people. They were Jews, they were Sinti, they were Roma, they were Christians, communists, socialists, forced laborers, prisoners of war, political opponents, nomads, handicapped, homeless people, homosexuals, the Russians, Czechs, they were French, Belgians, Spaniards, and they could go on for 51 countries that were here in Buchenwald. Buchenwald is a place where horror was engendered by humiliation and contempt for mankind. The words Juden das Sein, to each as he deserves, adorn the gate. You have to see that.
Jedem das Seine.
From the backside. Seine, yeah. The cynical slogan with its sinister inhuman connotations was a mockery to the classic Latin ideals of justice. What greater insult could be found for those incarcerated there? Ideology had overcome human dignity. The victims of absolute despotism, of unbelievable, unbridled inhumanity, and ideological hatred warn us never to forget that our actions must always be guided by the moral principles of inviolability of human dignity. We in Thuringia must live with the fact that Weimar, linked throughout the world with lofty traditions of humanism, lies next door to Buchenwald for the rest of eternity. Nowhere else can the Janus head, showing contempt for mankind and culture, horror and hope, be seen as clearly on the Edisburg Hill. For other concentration camps, the end of, in 1945, came in 45, but not for Buchenwald. The end of Nazism was not the end of the world of concentration camps. The fact that people were victims of inhuman treatment and fresh injustices were committed in Edisburg Hill even after 1945 is also among our memories of Buchenwald. You have rightly reminded people that we Germans must emerge from and understand two dictatorships. That Buchenwald is, as you said in an interview a few months ago, the place in Europe where the history of the present century converged and revealed itself more dramatically. Democratically reunited Germany is the only country in Europe that can and must come to terms as a nation with two totalitarian experiences of the present century. We're almost done. Only memories can prevent the reoccurrence of dreadful crimes. Memories, wounds heal, but scars remain. And the scars must remain to remind us of the wounds. The terrible years and atrocities committed in the German name must be remembered, and the memory of them must never die. Only those who realize the infinite grief that mankind can inflict upon mankind will do all they can to prevent such things from happening again. That means you, young people. Only these who are watchful will be able to recognize and repulse the first origins, can identify approaching barbarity and prevent the worst. Only those who can remember the horror and imagine the cruelty will find the strength needed to create a better world. Only the glimpse of the past allows us to look clearly into the future. The democratic constitutional state is dependent upon the participation of its people. It thrives on scrutiny, not on looking away. A strong, staunch democracy needs a well-developed democratic awareness. Politicians must help in its development, but so must parents, schools, and churches, the media, social institutions, political parties, and society as a whole. We must all make sure that our social and political identity, our self-confidence, and our democratic convictions are so strongly developed that they can be staunchly withstand all that might jeopardize our democratic and law-based order. The fact that, despite the goodwill, the fathers who drew up the Weimar Constitution in the very building failed to achieve this is among the factors that enabled the National Socialists to seize power. We must stand up for freedom, law, and dignity of the individual at all times and all places, because freedom, law, and human dignity are the hallmark of democracy. We must interfere, oppose in good time, and show civil courage because civil courage is indispensable to the repulsion of radical and extremist tendency. We must stand up for freedom and peace throughout Europe and the world, because the terrible self-destruction of Europe through the demon of National Socialism must not be allowed to happen again. The last paragraph. I hope that we will be able to link the past to the future and build bridges between yesterday and tomorrow. We do not want to forget. This is why we are here. But we also want to build a better future together. This, too, is why we are here. And I thought, that isn't his whole speech, but I thought that was, he hit it right on the button. Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming here and giving us this interview, Mr. Sanders.
You're welcome.
It's October the 27th, 1997, and my name is Leah Hecker. Mr. Sanders, where are we here?
You're in the crematorium at Buchenwald.
And when were you here for the first time?
It had to be either the 12th of April or the 13th, either those 2 days.
And can you tell us what you saw then?
All I remember as we came here was seeing people milling around and seeing the crematorium. That's really all I remember. I really wanted to get out of here. You know, we were ambulance drivers and I wanted to be on the road, away from this place, whatever it was. Because we didn't know at that time what this was. And it was pretty scary. Come in and see these ovens and unburnt body parts. And we didn't want to stay very long. We did not stay very long. But as far as handling any, as I said, I was an ambulance driver, but as far as handling anyone here, we didn't. Later on, we were involved with handling some people that had been here. But as far as being here, we were here a short time. And of course, this is all clean now, but when we were here, it was just terribly dirty. I don't know whether it was ashes or what made it dirty, but evidently from what we heard later on, was that they'd run out of coke to fire the furnaces. And so they couldn't use it. So the bodies actually piled up. Yes.
Do you remember your first reaction when you came in here?
Well, you know, we'd been in the war from Normandy on. And as ambulance drivers, we'd seen wounded, dying, dead, along the road and so on. We'd come to prisoner of war camps, and we'd be released in prisoners of war, and we'd actually taken American prisoners out of those camps in the ambulances, but we'd never, ever dealt with anything like this, you know. And we weren't asked to deal with this. So we just saw it. Couldn't believe what we saw, really, and did not know what we were, what it was, or why not.
Truthfully, I wanted to get out of here. It was scary. I mean, even though we'd seen war and planes and bombings and everything else, this was a scary place. And I was only 20 years old, and my partner, he was only 20 or 21. And it was just, well, you've probably seen pictures of this thing later on. I mean, American photographers came in later and took pictures of everything. Correspondents were in here. Andy Rooney, who was a correspondent for Stars and Stripes, was here in Weimar, but I don't think he ever got over here to see Buchenwald. He talked about it, but never really did, as far as I know. He said he wrote a book about his time in the military. He said he was in Weimar and he heard about this place, but if anyone was here, they should have seen it, you know. Really. And I'm not sure, but someone ordered us to go to Ardbeg. And they ordered us to go to Ardbeg just to see why we had to come. And I think it was Patton, probably, that said, or maybe Eisenhower, he wanted all the troops that were in the area to go see these places to see why this had to be done, why we had to win this war. It's the only reason I can think of why we went to Ardbeg, because we were ordered to go there.
You said when you came here, you saw people. Were there live people here in this room?
I don't remember. There were live people milling around. Yeah, but, you know, we were milling around too. And I said, let's go. Let's get out of here, you know.
Can you remember touching anything?
Pardon?
Can you remember touching anything?
No, we did not touch anything. Nothing.
Can you remember the sounds or the smell?
Oh, smell, oh, sure. You'll never forget burnt body smell. I mean, we experienced that coming through Europe. We experienced burnt bodies, and that's a smell. I mean, if I smell it right now, I know exactly what it was. So, yeah, you can smell that, but it's a long time ago, you know? Unbelievable that this could happen. But they had to have some way to dispose of the people that died here, I suppose. it was beyond our 20-year-old imagination. If we'd have known we were in history, we'd have tried to record it. There was no reason I couldn't have kept a journal, or couldn't have had one of our people, one of the soldiers with us, had a camera. He took some pictures. He has some pictures that he took at Ardbeg. Yes.
And who were you with?
We were with the 3rd Army that came through here, and we were with the 4th Armored Division as we came through this area.
And who were you with when you entered this room?
I was with a man named Ray Lockhart. He was I was with him on the ambulance.
Can you remember any of his reactions?
He was like I was. He said, let's go. You would too. Because there wasn't anything. We weren't here for a purpose. And our job was to go along with the troops and take their wounded back to the evacuation hospital. It was our job. And by this time, the war was winding down. I mean, for all practical purposes, the war was over by this time. There were a few diehard German soldiers that would put up a little bit of resistance, but it was just a mad dash here. And so this was in April 13th, well, it was over by May 8th. And by that time, we'd gone south to Regensburg and then back up into Czechoslovakia.
Do you think you will ever forget the pictures that you've seen here?
You can't. Just like, you know, Mr. Gruner was only here for maybe 4 months, but you saw him today. He's never going to forget this place, or Auschwitz, or what happened to him. I mean, it's seared in his brain. I mean, when I went home, like a lot of other young Americans, we just wanted to go on with our lives and forget all this, which I did. We had a family, and we went on with our lives, and it hadn't been until the last maybe 10 or 15 years that this has come back, and it happens to all old soldiers. When their life was going down the hill, they remember those things that got in their brain early on, whereas I couldn't really tell you what happened 2 weeks ago, you know. But I could tell you exactly what happened 52 years ago in a lot of places here. A lot of memories that I know exactly what happened. But here we were young. We wanted to go home. The people in Czechoslovakia asked us when we were coming. You know, we said, we don't know. We're not politicians. But we wanted to go home. The Russians, they wanted to stay. I mean, this is great. They wanted to stay. All we wanted to do was, hey, let's go home. And so we did. So that's what happened. The politicians decided where that border was going to be, you know. Yalta, basically, as we learned later. In fact, it was along through here, through this area, that when President Roosevelt died, and we heard it on a half-track, you know, half-track had communications. We didn't have communications. We heard that Roosevelt died and Truman took over, so that was it. But if you were here, you three, when you were 20 years old, I don't think you'd ever forget it either. Do you?
Thank you, Mr. Sanders.